Welcome back to another episode of Breaking the Line Podcast. I'm Samuel.
And I'm Charlton.
Taking a deep dive into the arcs of mind and Corey. As always, I'm Sam.
And I'm Charlton.
And as always, we're taking a deep dive.
We're breaking the line.
Exactly.
Well, today we're...
well, today, as we're breaking the line, we're going to be going into the song, New Way to Be Human. There's a new way to be human. That's my bit.
Anyways, so of course, this is New Way to Be Human by Switchfoot. This song was written by Tess Buller.
Represent San Diego, though, because Switchfoot from San Diego.
All right.
Yeah, it's true.
Well, who cares?
My brother. Wow. The original three members, John Foreman and Tim Foreman, they're brothers. And makes the drummer, sense. Chad. I don't remember his last name. They were in the, amphitheater that my brother got to see one back in the day. The lead guitar, Drew Shirley. Was originally part of the band. I don't know. Just random facts about them. Mm. But yeah, I'm a big fanboy.
I can tell.
It's a good song, though.
Yep.
Track one on the second album. That's the album, New Way to Be Human, track one.
Anyways, so the song, kind of a fun song. It's got like that classic Switchfoot feel.
Oh, yeah.
I remember because like this video is from back in 2010, which... as you'll notice very quickly, I'm actually in the song, this version that
with
we have.
With your mullet? Is your mullet in the song?
I have my mullet in the song.
Yeah.
So we get to see, you know, Charlton back in, you know, what, 13 years ago?
Yeah.
Doing mime and stuff like that. This would have been like year and a half, 2 years, somewhere in there, into my mime career. This was a very fun one because, like, the Branson team didn't always do a whole lot of, like, newer songs. And, of course, this was, like, a newer song back.
Right, for what the time was.
Sure,
it was newer.
Time was, yeah.
Yeah. And the song is like 04, like when it actually came out.
Mm-hmm. And like that's pretty new for what the Branson team did. We have always done songs from like the 80s, 90s,
yeah.
And 20s.
Early 2000s. Yeah. Cool. Well, let's get into it.
All right, let's do it. So, yeah. In case you're wondering, I am the long-haired idiot in the center there. So,
no, that's Alan. Oh, wait, no. Just
no, he's the short-haired idiot in the center.
Nah, yeah. I got him. No. Fun music. I do love the idea of the prop. So, song talking about the trends and how they change and how, in some ways, Christians are supposed to be set apart from culture of, like, not chasing after the newest things of some level of consistency.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a lot of props.
It is a lot of props.
Especially keeping them organized, especially when you throw in the chain near the end. Like, we've definitely had more than one malfunction in the song of props.
Yep, and... just keeping them separate alone is difficult enough, and also making sure you have enough for everybody.
Correct number. So we had rules about, like, if you're the last person and you don't have enough, what do? You kind of, like, if you have too many, how you kind of drop them and just don't pretend they weren't there.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of logistic issues with this song.
Oh, yeah.
Especially trying to do the mind technique while changing lights is significantly, like, harder than you think. Mm-hmm. Because by the time you have, like, enough beats of music to get it on, it's time to take it off.
Basically.
I do like how the song visually looks with the passing trends and things, but also feel like there's some plot development issues.
Yeah. It does, like, develop, and I use that pretty generously. Mm-hmm. Because, like, it gets the idea across as, like, you know, these are the trends that are happening and the trends are ever-changing and stuff like that. It gets that point across. But I think by, like, about here, if we got it. Like, everything is...
said and done.
Yeah, we're said and done. We need to move on. Now, granted, like, they do move on. We got kind of, like, the conclusion coming into it. So, structurally, it's okay.
But right.
I feel like the second, like, somewhere halfway, maybe three-quarters of the way through what would otherwise be... you know, the first act, if you will.
Right.
Something kind of needs to develop a little bit more for it to keep pace.
Something that should be said here is normally there's a physical prop chain as opposed to everyone mind prop here, but probably just got forgotten or something with the song.
Yeah, because, like, I very distinctly remember the chains being drove across there. So the fact that there isn't one, I'm like, wait, do we just, like, not have the chains that day?
Right, or something went wrong with them. Yeah, and cleaning up the song is also a mess.
Oh, yeah. It just look at the ground and you'll see.
Yes.
Like, you kind of have to just, you're going to step on them. It's fine. Just
yeah.
Don't
they're
hurt
cheap
them too
99
much.
Cent store box ladies.
Uh-huh.
No, and granted, you throw more at Satan here at the end as far as you're putting it on his hand.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that my team used to do is that the first, the Christian, instead of both of them going to all the people, the original Christian would pray in the middle, and Satan would try to go behind him and trap them, and then the Christian would spin away and he'd get trapped doing the, like, mind technique. So, kind of like how you have here at the end, but he'd be on his knees with his hands up so that when people came up and threw his legs, they'd throw off his head, throw him his arms, whatever. And then eventually, yeah, the guys would come up and take the chain and tie him up too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think this is, that's what's supposed to be happening right here. Is the
chain. You guys don't know what they're doing.
And we're like, we don't have it.
Direct man. Oh, I like that. I'd never seen that ending before with the whole, like, yeah, new way to be human. We just had everyone prepped, but I do like the entering into a new humanity sense.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Well, that's the song, so let's talk about it. Purpose and message of the song?
Yeah, so what honestly I think really excels about this song in Purpose and Message is that this is one of those songs that I would, like, take to a school or have, like, a secular audience of youth. Because, like, there's, you know, different audiences for different things, but this one works really well in that it's is relevant to a lot of kids and stuff.
Especially in, yeah, the school system or otherwise where you got people who are swayed by trends and whatnot. This hits directly at why trends shouldn't be followed necessarily, or why, not to be like a stickler of trends in general, but why going with the flow isn't always a good idea.
Yep, and I appreciate that it doesn't just say, oh, trends are a bad idea just inherently because they're trends, but instead it takes it a different direction and be like, hey, look, trends are bad, yes, but also why are you trying to be like everybody else when you should be like Christ?
Right.
Which takes it a completely different direction than what the world would want to take it. Because, like, technically that's a pretty secular message of not following trends.
Right.
But to make it a Christian nice little twist.
Disney song here of, like, be individual, be yourself, be true to yourself.
Exactly. But instead twist it a little bit and say, no, it's not just about that. It's also about, like, be more like Christ. Be,
right.
You know, take off the parts of the old you and become, you know.
Yeah, like, it hits on. Gone, new, it hits it on a positive message. It's not saying, like, just get away with that. It's saying there's a new way to be human. So a new lifestyle, a new actions are necessary or called for because of that.
Right.
And it uses the lays in a very tactful way to demonstrate that message. It doesn't hit on one specific trends, you know, like baggy pants, God forbid.
You know, it is funny that you mentioned that because, yeah, like, it is a silly thing. Like, oh, this trend is all these lays. But, yeah, it doesn't
actually. Generic.
But it's generic enough to, like, it makes it relevant constantly because it's generic enough and, like it's not about baggy pants. It's not about cool haircuts. It's not about, you know, wristbands or something like that.
Yeah.
It's not about that. The thing doesn't matter. The fact is that, you know, it's about following trends, giving into others around you just simply because you want to be cool as opposed to following Christ. So that's
right. And even the more serious things like drugs, alcohol, or whatever it is that you would do to fit in or be cooler, that would be riskier in a different kind of way, not just a weird fashion trend. Shout out to weird fashion trends. I was trying to think of one.
Shout out to, like, t-shirts and pants.
Exactly.
Is that a fashion trend?
Our t-shirts and... Let us know down in the comments below. Are t-shirts and pants a fashion trend? I'm wearing, like, it's what we're wearing right now. It's like...
Yeah. I mean, it's technically fashion.
It's fashion.
Like, people didn't always wear this. People wore robes back in the day.
We are fashion experts, but, you know, let us know in the comments what you think.
I have 3 doctorates in fashion.
Writing, I'm a doctor on a piece of paper doesn't make you a doctor.
I got it off the internet.
Oh,
it's professional.
That's definitely professionally done then.
Yeah.
All right. So what are some things that worked well in the song? I think we already mentioned the lays, solid, generic way to get the point across.
Yep. Now, I like to kind of go along with that. The use of props in songs is always kind of a rough point because first of all, with it being mime, you want to have as few props as possible because you want to focus on the mime. However, I also am of the thought that you don't have to not have props at all whatsoever. I mean, heck, we use things like the Jesus sash and the Satan cape. And
easy identification of characters. Yep.
Right. And we use those pretty often. Now, where you cross from, like, this is something helpful to the song to this is now making me lazy in the song, got to find, you know, don't cross that line. Here, it makes it very easy to understand the point of the song. Like, it emphasizes the
to not aspect. Use the prop, you'd have to have everyone doing, like, the same motion or the same action, the same fashion trend, which almost gets a little too specific and becomes, like, how do you keep showing that they're wearing baggy pants? Or how do you keep showing that they're, I don't know, doing jumping jacks?
Or whatever.
It becomes a useful prop because it lets it be generic and clear still, which is hard to do without the prop.
Yes. And so I think it does that well.
The
prop aspect, excellent.
Yep, solid, definitely on the prop side. I love the integration of the robot technique, showing that people are robotic or not free, that there's something that they are slaves to. Obviously, it's dependent on everyone on the team doing the mime like robot really well, so difficulty goes up because of that. But it's a good integration of that purpose there.
Yep. And fun fact, this is where like that specific song right there is how I learned how to do the robot from Tess, of course, because she's phenomenal. And through that, I actually was able to develop my skills in that and be able to, in the future, teach the robot technique to other people. So
nope, I remember my sister-in-law helping lead the team at the time, Jesse, lined everybody up and had everyone do the robot. And I thought I was this hot stuff and like, I could totally do the robot. I've been doing this for a while. And like, I was one of the last people up there and getting correction on how to do it. And it was definitely like a good skill to learn as far as the repertoire of mime and tucks and resistance and whatnot.
Yep. Yeah. Because it's like, as far as mime technique goes, it's one of the techniques that I would recommend a lot of people learn simply because of how it emphasizes techniques like tucks and resistance, which in mime, like I would argue that like, if you get these three techniques down, tucks, resistance, and emotion, you get those three things down, like you're golden. Like there's a lot of specific techniques. There's the mime walk.
Or how to do it, the types of hands, the feet positions. Sure. Yeah, but like all that comes from specifics, not like the generic, like you get the golden triangle there.
Yeah. When you get those three, like you can do any song with, you know, excellence pretty well off the bat, just because of how widely applicable those are.
Yeah.
And honestly, this song with the robot uses all three of those.
Right. Solid. Anything else you'd say would work well in the song? Because I'm about to rip into it.
Jesus. one thing that I would also add that works well with it is like at the very end, having kind of that, like, we could say it comes full circle, because with the passing of all the lays and everything, and then finally, you know, like it comes back onto Satan, and now he's getting those put onto him. It kind of feels like a satisfying ending. Mm-hmm. Now, granted, as far as like the message goes, maybe it doesn't make the most sense, because it's like
you could say that. That's where I was going to give it some negative points. Yeah.
It doesn't make a whole lot of sense as far as like the message goes, but like I like the style of it going full circle. That's where I would give it.
I like the full circle and the ending, this ending particularly, of not just generic praying, but that like we are all like we're human, the new human. Like I feel like you got some good theological ties that you could put into that for not just a school system going under trends, but what does like new humanity look like?
Right.
Cool. All right. What would you critique about it? Because my biggest thing is the plot. Like, it feels like there's plot holes. So we have a relatively generic plot of, like, person falls into trends, and then person rejects trends, and everyone else follows. You know, kind of a trope of the one person being different that everyone follows. I don't like it when a song has the main character between, like, let's say the Christian or God character and the devil, and they're just like fighting at her, and then she chooses. That always feels like chaotic and not helpful. Maybe it's just because it's overdone. It's confusing to me or not clear. You know what I'm talking about?
I get you. Because it also does, with those types of songs, it feels like, you know, Satan and God have equal power.
Yeah, maybe that's
and
it.
And I feel like that, of course, just theologically has a lot of problems with it.
Right.
And for a song like this one, there is no God character in it, and so we have just the Satan aspect of it. Now, other songs do kind of have a God character and a Satan character kind of fighting back and forth, which, that causes negative theological implications.
Right. So, I'd also have a plot hole with, like, why does Satan then choose to bind everyone up when, well, it's like, fine, I can't have you, so I'm going to double bind to them. Like, weren't they kind of already trapped under the lays? Or why is it that all the people, like, kind of collapsed, like it doesn't give a reason for where the plot's going.
The way I've understood that is like it's reaching for that concept of the fall after that, so this is the end result. So during this whole time you've been following trends, you've been being like everybody else, being like the world, kind of doing whatever, and then finally this is where that takes you, is destruction.
Right.
Now granted, where that kind of gets into a little bit of an awkward spot is, well, if it technically leads you to destruction, well then you shouldn't be able to come out of destruction at the end, because if the end result then of course would be hell, is kind of like what that seems to be indicative of, then
right. Either that, or you could say fire or like earthly consequences at best, or just the general binding of being bound to sin on earth before like a redemption is possible after the fall, in that sense. So One thing that our team used to do is when it has those lines of like, there, where's our inspiration when all our heroes are gone, is we'd have the main person finally being desperate, like, wait, how am I going to get out of this? And they go talk to one person, and the person like steps forward and does something like heroic, and then does the mind fall and comes down. The next person would be like philosophy, or give, like, it would show the maybe the futility or the vanity of different ways of getting out of these things. Mm-hmm. And then finally with like the strong man in the middle, and even physical strength, wisdom, or whatever, is all going to fall short to get you out of this whole kind of thing. Maybe that added, I think, a little bit to me. But even still, like, why did the Christian just then go to get people free? Why did the Christian, like, talk to the audience or read the Bible? You know, like, there's a couple of spots where maybe you should introduce the Christian later. Maybe, you know, there's just some stuff that I would want to move around to get a clear plot points to this.
Yeah, I could use a little bit of sifting out to make it work.
That's my biggest problem with it. That's partly why our team doesn't do it anymore. I just feel like there's some plot holes.
Yeah. No, and honestly, like, kind of what we talked about a little bit before of, like, the pacing issues, that is something that I would critique a lot, where it feels like the, like, I could sum it up into, like, two sentences of what happens.
Yeah.
It's like, there's lays that get passed down a couple of times, and then they all break down, and then
they get saved.
You know, I feel like that's a very bare bones thing. Like, it's a good concept for something. I feel like you could build something on top of that would make it really interesting. But I feel like it is pretty bare bones in and of itself.
Yeah, one thing our team used to do is, like, Satan was the person selling the goods, and so that kind of showed that it was the poison apple behind it. So it wasn't just the fact that they were passing the lays, but that there was Satan making the sale to the person, emphasizing the fact that it's not a good thing inherently, that there's something wrong about it, and that in the end, yeah, it'll bite you. All right, theologically, anything that you would think about changing or developing?
I think, honestly, like, looking at the theology of the song, it does kind of it does have some, like, holes that we've already talked about. I don't feel like I need to go back over those, but one thing that I do want to emphasize is, like, when the Christian comes in and brings the person into, you know, the knowledge of Christ, if you will, and then that they go through and bring people to salvation. One thing that I think is really weird theologically is that suddenly everybody stops being, you know, part of the conformity, and then they all join conformity into Christ. And so it feels like, theologically, there's a little bit of antithesis, but, like,
yes,
at the same time, like, it mirrors the sin, the main
thing like we're trying aspect to get away from here.
Yeah, it mirrors that then at the very end.
Yeah, I remember we'd have people do, like, different movements, like dancing or Frida, like, they would show that, like, there was a difference between them and now, and so instead of a unified thing at the end, I guess we all prayed, but, like, there was a little bit of differences in how we were demonstrating the freedom that we had in Christ.
Right.
I do like the message, though, of, you know, right in line with Galatians, like, old self isn't crucified. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So you have lots of ways to share the gospel from the song too that aren't just tied to following the trends.
Right.
Cool. Mm-hmm. All right. And rating, clarity, difficulty, style. Clarity, the props make it really clear and simple, but the plot line makes it weak. So it's falls right in the middle. I feel like a 6 is, like, you're getting the message across, but then you're gonna have questions about, like, why do they go over here, or why did the person do that now? Like,
yeah,
the plot line is what brings it real down.
Yep, I was gonna go for a 6. Yep. And it is mostly exactly what you said, like, the use of props, excellent. It makes things clear. Like, I get it, like, you watch it and you understand. It's like,
right,
it's about trends, it's about conformity and who we are then in Christ and who we should be.
Like, right,
you get it. It makes sense. Now, it is also a simpler message, but also, like, I want to say a lot could be done with it.
Right.
And so it kind of falls a little bit short of what I
would think. Also want to somehow show that the lays aren't just, like, something generic, like, I don't know, wearing a shirt with a Pokemon logo on it. Like, in my opinion, that's harmless, not a big deal. Following that fashion trend is not going to kill you or send you to hell. But if it was something more serious, like drugs and alcohol, then that could. So the fact that Satan is selling it shows that it's bad. I would want some other consequence to come upon, like, the people who wear the lace. Like, they wear it and, like, I don't know.
And, like, they get chained up or something?
That's all generic. I would say, like, as soon as they put it on, like, one of their arms doesn't work or something. or like they start coughing too. Like you would want to show some level of ailment or how you are not made to do this. And so by doing it, you are breaking apart the way the world was supposed to be in God's original order.
Right. Because the fashion trends is not about the trends.
Like, right.
It's about what they stand for. It's about, yes, you know, the conformity to the things of this world,
yes,
which is widely applicable, like you mentioned, drugs and alcohol, but also like just sin in general,
mm-hmm,
and things like that, that have nothing to do with fashion. That have,
right,
nothing to do with how you look or how you dress or anything like that, but how you behave and how,
right,
you...
Right. So I don't want it to become a message of like, don't wear baggy pants.
Right.
Like, I want it to be a message about why sin is a problem. So, right, just keeping that line clear,
mm-hmm,
was important. That's probably, yeah, yeah, why I'm going on the lower side.
I can agree with that. That makes sense.
All right. Difficulty, technique is hard, but like as far as the actual choreography, most of the plot points are pretty simple. Like, come here, then here's the lyrics for this. Most of the issue is going to just be in the technique. So I don't like difficulty. I'm giving it like a three.
Three. I was gonna give it a four
because
like most of the points go to the robot, pretty much.
Right, and even if you're bad at the robot, like you're gonna get that most people are the robot.
Yeah.
We definitely had, you know, not everyone's at the same par level when it comes to that, and that is the background part. So,
yep,
sure, we're going to work on technique, but it's like, if you did I Will Follow Christ and one person was a little like less good about the walk, like you're still going to get the point.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. Like, even the, like, we could say the hardest part might be like the main.
Yeah.
The main, still pretty easy.
Like, yeah.
The main, not that difficult.
Exactly.
Like, the main in and of itself, I could probably give like maybe a three in difficulty too, which for our main part is pretty dead gum low.
Take it.
And then for the background people, like, of course I would give them a little bit higher ratings just simply because of the robot and,
yep,
nothing else. So like I would give it a four just simply because the robot counts for most of the points and the simplicity of the song and the choreography.
Similarly with style, I'd probably give it points for the robot and points for the props and then less points for everything else.
Like, right. Yeah.
It has cool elements of it. It's a unique song. And so just inherently being unique gives it some more props because of the props.
Props for the props.
Exactly. Six too high?
I was going to go about a six.
Yeah.
I was either going to go six or seven. I was leaning toward the six.
I was going to go with five or six.
Somehow we keep rolling it around.
Exactly.
Now, the reason that I would give it a six or a seven, kind of leaning toward that range, first of all, the robot isn't used that much.
It's true.
When it looks good, it's very clean. Like, especially when everybody's in, you know, using.
Oh, yeah. Because it's supposed to be with the music, then you have that clean look the entire time.
Like, when it looks clean, it just, like, it's really
cool. It
hits
so good, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then, like, the style with the use of the props, that gets extra points for me, because, like, no other song does that.
Right.
Unique. With the lays.
Now, I'm not a fan of one prop songs, but, like, if you're going to do it, this would be a way to go for it.
Yeah, this is an example of it well done.
Yes.
And well done, not because like, oh, this would look cool if it happened to be in there, but also because like it makes the message more clear. And that is of utmost importance.
Absolutely. Yeah. Cool. Well, as always, the original video is down in the description. Talk about the song. Tell us that we're heretics somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know. Come up with your own theology. Yell at us. Cool Bible verses at us.
Like,
or tell us
Christian.
How we're right. If you have other Bible verses that are relevant to the song or whatnot.
Yeah.
And then, as always,
mash that like subscribe. Oh.
The thing that looks like this, or like this, depending on how you're watching, if it's mirrored, that thing, you want to click on it or tap it with your finger. Go like this.
Yeah, go like this.
Makes me feel good. Gives me that little dopamine hit.
Yeah. One like equals one dopamine hit for Samuel.
It's actually true.
Yeah.
Because it'll come in that slowly. But, as always, I'm Samuel.
And I'm Dalton.
Breaking the line.